Hey, what's up, guys? Thank you so much for tuning back in to another episode of We The People. I'm Derek Butler, and today I'm joined with two dope individuals here in the city of Chicago who have great organization and companies that are making an impact here in the city. Today we're talking about millennials and entrepreneurship. People say that millennials are stepping away from those traditional type of jobs, don't want to necessarily sit at a desk working 9 to 5, but pretty much turning their passions into the work that they do every single day. So I thought it was befitting to bring these two individuals together to talk about some of the stuff that they're doing here in the city of Chicago. So thank you guys so much for joining me here at Nella's Pizza y Pasta in Hyde Park.
Exquisite. I feel so fancy.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Anytime you spell "and" with an E, you
right.
can't. It's just fancy.
Like, I want my backyard to be like this one day.
This is a beautiful
dope
backyard.
Minus the mosquitoes.
It's a lot of mosquitoes.
It is.
We got a lot more mosquitoes than I'm used to.
It is.
It's going to be a lot of those jokes.
It just rained.
Get ready.
It just rained in Chicago. So, like,
quite
the mosquitoes are
in abundance.
Yeah, they are. It's cuffing season.
They're trying to find
who they're looking for. So we just want to learn like a little bit more about you guys, some of the work that you're doing in the city, how you guys got started, and then just kind of end with like some advice for other people who are trying to turn their passions into the work that they do every single day. So in the midst of eating and drinking, just kind of whoever wants to start, tell me a little bit about yourself, the name of your company, how it got started, and then we'll kind of go from there.
All right, so my name is Myles Gage, and born and raised on the south side of Chicago, and I'm the co-founder of Rapunzl Investments. And Rapunzl Investments is a social investing application that teaches people how to invest in the stock market. And how it works is we give each user $10,000 to create simulated stock portfolios, and it's geared towards those who have been curious about the world of investing, but A, don't know where to begin, or B, apprehensive about putting actual money up. So to the people who don't know where to begin, like I said, it's a social investing app. So what that means is you can see what companies your friends are buying and selling, because we look to our friends as far as like what new music is out, what movies, what clothes. So why shouldn't we be having this discussion when it comes to stock market or when it comes to investing? Because for the most part, that is something that's been not talked about in, you know, minority communities, because we don't know about that. So we're really just trying to shift that narrative. And then in addition, people heard about investing, but you know, they're scared, they're fearful. They see the 2008 recession, they're like, well, I don't want to put my money in the market, I'm gonna lose it, I'm gonna keep it under this mattress, it's gonna be good there. And you know, we're just really trying to dispel that narrative and allow people to get acclimated with the world of investing by giving them fictitional dollars so they can see and track their trades over time as they actually hone in on an investment strategy.
That's what's up.
Yeah,
that's pretty dope.
Thank you.
And you are actually in finance, like as far as like you're 9 to 5,
I'm
right?
I'm fully immersed in it.
Okay.
I wake up, I breathe, sleep, and eat finance, basically. So I'm kind of full right now. I only have one slice of pizza. That's what I'm off of. But yeah, I mean, and to that point, I studied finance at University of Illinois in Champaign. Mm-hmm. And I knew that I wanted to go into the banking field in the sense that I wasn't totally sure what I wanted to do, like as an adult, but I knew that having a degree in finance would allow me to at least get a job. And then by working at a bank, I would be able to see different businesses and understand what it takes to make a good business operate. And so what I'm doing on my 9 to 5 actually helps me with, you know, the 5 to 9, you feel me?
It's
pretty cool.
Yeah. I know Xavier can talk a little to that too. I remember a conversation we had recently about putting in that same amount of work to your stuff as you do to your 9 to 5. So
yeah,
tell us
you
a little
were slacking. You're slacking, bro. Gotta add an accountability partner coming in.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So tell us what's going on with you, Xavier.
Yeah. Chief executive of a social impact consulting firm here in Chicago called Justice Informed. We focus on 4 main service areas. One is diversity, equity, inclusion. The second is public policy, informed corporate social responsibility. The third is equity-focused philanthropy, and the final one is community engagement practices.
Yep.
So we look at all of that and we say, you know, we've got what we've gotten based off of what we've been doing. So what's the delta between today and the tomorrow that, you know, people really need? And then how do we translate what change means through an equity lens, meaning that we're fundamentally looking at the inputs and the root causes rather than the opportunities around compliance or marketing or fear, which often drives people's diversity inclusion strategies or their CSR or otherwise.
So your company is kind of for profit. I mean, it's
not kind of. It is.
Okay, it's for profit,
yeah,
right?
Yep.
Tell me about how it got started.
How
did you get the capital, the money to kind of get started in doing what you're doing? Was it
There was no capital. You know, I used to work at the University of Chicago. Before I did this, I worked at UFC, and I led what's called the Social Innovation and Philanthropy Strategy out at the Office of Civic Engagement there.
Cool.
And I let my boss know about maybe like a month and a half in advance that I would be leaving to start my company. And I had about 6 weeks worth of money on hand, and I jumped in. I knew at that point that you got to sell. You only got 6 weeks worth of cash, and rent comes by the month.
Right.
You got 1 month basically to figure this out. And so I left my job and I started it off. It's been an incredible journey ever since. We've been blessed with a lot of early successes, a lot of large national, some international and local partners and clients. You know, we've been able to grow. I've been able to hire staff, which has been great. It's been an interesting journey. The start of it though was ridiculous because I started it actually getting into a mastermind program. I was friends with this guy. Well, I wasn't really even friends with him. We ended up talking at a business event for the city treasurer, and he came up to me. He's like, "Hey, you're Xavier." And I was like, "Yeah." And I was like, "Oh man, you're Thomas." And he's like, "Yeah, yeah." And you know, we had heard about each other, but we never met really. And he said, "So tell me about what's your big dream." And so I told him about this idea I had, and he was just like, "That's a really good dream. Like, that's a pretty dope idea." And he said, "Can you do it?" And I was like, "Yeah, I can do it. You know, it is what it is. You know, I mean, it ain't nothing. You know, chilling. You know,
try it.
I mean, how many people you know names start with an X? You know, cannot do it."
It's a good letter right there.
But he was very serious about it, and I saw it in his eyes when he asked me again, "But can you do it?" And I looked him right in the eye and I said, "Yeah, I can do this." He said, "Okay, well, I'll be calling you." And sure enough, I got a correspondence maybe a week or so later, and he invited me to something called the Mastermind that he was piloting for himself, basically to say, "Hey, I know all these catalytic leaders who have these big dreams and big goals, but they are, as they say, half-assing on their dreams. Even though they're successful in life, got a good, great job at the University of Chicago, or you're already executing in a seven-figure company, but they had shared with him that there was something more out of life that they wanted." And so he invited me into this thing called the Mastermind, and I joined, and it was one of the most formative experiences because it linked me up with, you know, seven other people. All of them were entrepreneurs. I was the only one that wasn't. The only reason they even brought me in and allowed me in was because I got a network that's pretty beefy here in the city, and they wanted leads. you know, so a year of getting into shape, and it's incredible what having accountability and team and people pushing you beyond what you think your opportunities are right now or what your capabilities are to execute and get it done. So that led me to launch.
That's what's up. So what about you? Like, I know you've been in finance. Yeah. You went to school for finance. Like, that was something. I remember in college and undergrad, I was a film major.
Sure.
And we had to take an accounting class as a part of our like major requirements. That was the most struggle semester. I don't know what it was, but like just thinking about like all these numbers and money, I was just like, this is crazy.
It's a lot, yeah.
So how, I mean, for you being a finance major, did that stem from like your love?
So it goes way back even beyond college, which
no,
is crazy.
Finance,
so we're gonna.
It's money. It's numbers. I'm just like, this is too much for me.
So we're gonna take a little stroll down memory lane.
Do it.
So actually, I attended this elementary school not too far from here on 46 in Greenwood, Ariel Community Academy, which was founded by John Rogers and Arne Duncan, and they felt that in addition to the traditional science, English, math curriculum, that young people needed to be learning about the finance and economics, because regardless of what field path that you go into, you're gonna, you know, need to learn how to manage your money. And most people are ill-equipped when they get out of school or wherever it may be with their personal finances. So I got exposure to the stock market and finance when I was like in first grade. And so in the sixth grade, I actually began managing my own portfolio of stocks outside of school. And just to tell you a little bit about Ariel, so each sixth grade class is given $20,000 of real money to start managing. So I was on the junior board of directors, which was a small group of students that got to manage that money. And then in addition to that, I was a member of this teen investment club, Ujamaa Junior, and that's where I actually began managing my own money. And so in the eighth grade, I wrote this essay, or I entered this contest hosted by the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago, the Money Smart Kid contest, where I wrote this essay about how I plan to finance my college tuition, with my main point being liquidating a portfolio of stocks. And so, you know, these judges aren't expecting a 14-year-old from the South Side to be talking about a portfolio of stocks. So I won this contest, and my brother actually won it 2 years prior, or like 3 years before I did. And so we used to go on these speaking engagements around the city and talk to kids like from these urban neighborhoods. I love that word, urban, about the stock market, and showing them that we're no different from you, but because we got exposed to it, you all should be doing this. So
that seems to kind of be the purpose of your app.
And so it's so cool because, you know, as a result, one of my prizes was a full scholarship to University of Chicago Lab School for high school. And one of the first people that I met there was a guy named Brian Curcio, who ended up being like one of my best friends. And we ultimately ended up starting this app down the line in 2016. But our like common connection was the fact that we both have portfolios of stocks. And then we just noticed that, you know, even students at University of Chicago had no clue what was going on. And then this continued to be the case outside, like once we graduated and went on to college. And me, I had already always had a passion for exposing kids, especially from underserved communities, to the world of investing. So we ended up coming up with this idea in July of 2016 and just fleshed it out. Like, well, we can make this kind of a learning tool and engaging, because it's like we have all these social media that's just kind of like feeding us garbage and nonsense. So it's like, why don't we have something that's actually stimulating and can help people, you know, overcome their current economic circumstances? And so that's like the root of it. And so, you know, I graduated from U of I in May of 2016, and I had to get a job. So then I started working at the bank. And then we came up with this idea in July of 2016 as well. So the same time that I'm essentially starting work is the same time that this idea comes about. But, you know, I got some student loans, so I can't just go jump ship and do this full time. Yeah. You know, mom will be tripping, like, what you doing? Like, this is an idea, Rapunzl, this fairy tale, what you doing? You need a job. So from the time that I graduated, I had basically had two full-time jobs. And we put a pitch deck together. We went out to friends and family and just kind of like begged them for money. And we were able to, you know, raise a decent amount of capital, enough to get somebody to develop our idea that we had, Rapunzl. Yeah. And so people are always like, why'd you call it Rapunzl? So the genesis of the name is people view the world of investing and the returns of Wall Street as something that's perched up in its ivory tower. It's inaccessible for most people, so we're essentially rolling down there here and allowing everybody to climb the tower to financial success.
Dope.
So
I was also wondering, like, that was a question I had.
There we go.
So that's
thought
a pretty
it was
dope.
An urban thing around rap.
Urban thing around rap. Well, that's the part I don't tell people, you know?
Rapunzl.
That's pretty dope. I like that.
That's part two.
Yeah.
Cool. So I know, like, even for me, and I spoke with Xavier about this idea that I have, right? Mm-hmm. You think about the problem that you're trying to solve and create the solution. And sometimes the goal and mission, as you begin to talk to people, roll it out, do focus groups, the mission and like goal kind of like begins to evolve. Mm-hmm. Like for you guys,
yeah, kind of, it does.
Yeah.
So how did it kind of for you guys evolve and change as you begin to like deal with that idea more?
I mean, so initially the idea was like we were trying to really just come at hedge fund managers, in the sense that these investment guys just like talk about their different stocks on the golf course and create kind of like this platform for young people to, you know, go back and forth and really challenge people's ideas and see how good of an investment strategy there was. But I'm like, well, we can take it from a social impact standpoint and make it educational. We can really just target certain demographics who otherwise didn't get exposure for it.
Yeah.
And then we can see where that goes. And that's kind of like the route that we're on right now. And this past April, we actually partnered with the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago, and we hosted an investment challenge, and it was like 10 years from when I wrote that essay contest. And I was like, ooh, we could play with this one, in the sense that they still had that middle school essay contest, but they had nothing for high schoolers. So that's kind of what we ran with it. But basically, it's more about economic empowerment and exposing people to the stock market.
Yeah.
So not only can they become invested, but then they can start viewing themselves as an investment. Because to these companies, they're just consumers, and they don't even realize they're just giving all these companies money, but they're not benefiting from it. So we want, really want them to challenge where they're allocating their dollars. Yes. So they're not just buying Nike shoes. They're buying Nike stocks because they see that every time they buy those new pair of mics, you know, the company benefits from that. So really just really change that narrative and helping young people shift out of that consumer mentality and think more like investors. And I feel like that, you know, that could be huge right there.
Yeah, that's pretty dope. I think that the idea of, because even for me, like, finance, stock, investment, like, even still to this day, like, it's like, I have no idea. I know it's something that I need to be doing. Even when it comes to, like, 401k and, like, investing, it's just like, what does this even mean?
Right.
Like, I just want to, like, put this in my savings account, knowing good and well that, like,
it pays
those transfers happen every now and then.
Yeah.
What about you? Like, how did your mission or goal, like, kind of evolve?
Well, you know, I learned this the hard way. The first thing you do when you're an entrepreneur is you bite off too much. Mm-hmm. The second thing you do is you get scared about how much you just bit off. Third thing you do is you start prioritizing. And, you know, that was a journey that, you know, everyone tells you about. And entrepreneurship is something that I've learned. It's much like when I hear people talk about parenting. You can have all the dreams you want about what you think this thing is until you wake up and realize that you're your employer.
Yeah.
You don't know what that feels like. Like when there's no fallback, when this is your full time, when anything, you know, it's sort of like, you know, October 17th, 2017, when I woke up the day after I quit at the University of Chicago. And I remember saying, like, well, whatever I do, I have to come up with it. Right? Like, no one's going to tell me what my schedule is today. No one's going to, like, tell me what my plan of action should be. Nobody's going to tell me what I'm going to be evaluated on. I signed up to generate that myself. It's a humbling feeling. And so you immediately sign up for everything. And so, you know, I was like, we're going to be doing this, these, and those, right? And, you know, you have your first real moment of realizing what it takes to get one thing done well. You realize, like, okay, you know, you're going to build your reputation off of execution done consistently well, not just done consistently. Can't just execute all the time. It can be poor performance. And so, you know, the way we've evolved is originally I used to talk about Justice Informed as a company that was there to challenge the big ones, right? We're challenging McKinsey. We're challenging Deloitte. We're challenging Mercer. We're challenging, right? We're the upstart.
Yep.
We're the upstart, right? Got the hero story going on. And then I started talking with those firms. I started in some ways working with them. Some of them are clients now. Which is also interesting. And you know, it's kind of like when I talk about, I like scotch. Mm-hmm. And I like scotch because it's a slow drink. Nobody takes a shot of scotch.
Shouldn't.
You don't want to. You don't want to. Even if you could, you don't want to.
Right.
Like, you know, when I got into my 30s, I was like, yeah, there's a different space, right? Like, you get into that. And one of the things I would say is when somebody's put, you know, 100 years, 500 years into something, you don't take a shot of it.
Yeah.
Right? You savor. You figure out. You realize there's some artistry and mastery there. And that's an homage to time and the amount of intentionality that people put behind it. So the way we evolved was we got more focused.
Yeah.
You know, we really drilled down. And when I first started on October 17th last year, I thought that I was going to pick up all four of the service lines. And what we ended up doing was digging really, really deep into one of them and establishing some credibility and some thought leadership in ways that, you know, meant that I haven't had to do any hunting since. You know, we've got a 100% referral-based business.
How's that?
You know, all of our revenues right now are coming because somebody said, hey, you should go talk to X. Mm-hmm. Or have you heard about Justice Informed? And that's a really awesome thing.
Right.
And it's also a very fortunate thing.
And how long has it been around?
Just 11 months.
11 months.
Yeah, we grew it up to, you know, I started with six weeks cash on hand, six weeks of my bills, right? Not like operation cash, like my rent, my student loan debt,
the X fund,
you know, credit card payments, and, you know, Comcast and AT&T, you know, and, you know, we managed to grow it up to six figures in the first 6 months. We've been growing it ever since.
That
mostly came from focus, is what I mean. You know, the evolution should not always broaden you. it should also, it should primarily deepen you. And so next year in 2019, that's when I started around maybe a month or two ago, I started looking at, well, 2019, you know, as an entrepreneur, the first thing you think about in June is January, right? And January for an entrepreneur, I learned this past January, it's like thinking about Monday 31 times. Right? Like you got 31 Mondays in a row, right? You know, it's never going to be a longer time to finish everything, but it's also Monday,
right?
Right? Yeah. And so you immediately start thinking about Q1 in at the end of Q2.
Yeah.
And that's where I've started to look at, all right, now the pivot for 2019, now that we have reputation, we've got client lines in here, we've got some case, you know, some good success stories. Now we start building out, I can staff for that. Now we move to start digging deep into those like larger, harder to hit things like public policy informed CSR, which is really a fight of the large multinational corporations versus small D&I issues. You fired the black person too many times, you know, type stuff.
So you say we, is do you have a staff or is it just you?
Yeah, we got a team.
Dope.
Yeah, so I got
these like pay staff?
Or yeah.
Okay.
I don't believe in free. I don't believe. Well, that's one of the things that I enjoy about the company. I get to make it all up as I go.
Yeah.
And so everything that I know affects people of color in the city or in this world, I'm able to take on the position of affording them justice through the way that I lead. So everything from mandatory background checks to academic credentialing requirements for employment. Over to questions of age and how people should be. Like, we've got folks as young as 23 working in there. We got folks who are in their 60s as community consultants, right? And that's the point, right? To show that you really do need inclusion, but also you do grow more by having different people. The challenge is whether the person who's saying that all of it needs to be held together actually has the capacity to do so. And that's often where it falls apart. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one of the challenges of even being 24 and wanting to work with friends and helping, you know, that's one of the things that I've noticed, that just because they're your friends doesn't mean they're the most qualified people to work with you.
Yeah, no,
that's one thing, you should keep, you know, friends and business separate.
Yeah.
And you should really be judging the quality of your staff by the merit and the capacity of their work that you're doing. And the nearest time or the soonest that exhibit itself, you have to make sure you handle it accordingly, because you know the emotions do come into it. You don't want to necessarily sever those ties or you know worsen the relationship. You want to make sure that it's tough though, and that's so super challenging. And that's just like the biggest thing, is you want to have like the most qualified people that are going to be on your team. You don't just do stuff because you like somebody. They have to really be adding value.
Yeah.
That's a serious thing, because it's the thing. If they're not, then it's a detriment, and it doesn't help. Progress, you digress. That's one thing that I've just like learned in the past 6 months, which has been very challenging, you know?
I mean, it sounds like you guys as companies and organizations are doing amazing, but when you first got started, like, what were some of those initial fears as far as like just taking that first step of like establishing like your own thing?
I mean, you know, the analogy that I tell anybody, being an entrepreneur is like being on the coolest roller coaster, in the sense that there's always this looming sense of uncertainty, but occasionally some cool stuff happens. But the thing is, you just really have to trust your instinct, and you only fail if you give up. And that's the thing. And the thing is, we've been kicked down so many times, even though we've only started it or been around since July of 2016, but it's just persevering and really keeping like a strong support system that's going to encourage you to keep going, because there's so many times when it's like you don't want to do it, but you know when you see the impact, or when people come up to you and be like, oh, I use your app and it's like really making a difference, and you're just like, I didn't even like, really, it's crazy. And I'm like, all right, well, I guess we might be on to something. Those are those things that just kind of like keep you going. Or then like you'll get some advice for some older person who's been in your shoes before, and you're like, no, this is part of the process. You know, you just don't get this upward trajectory. It's kind of up and down. And I mean, I even got some great advice from the city treasurer, and he said like your career path isn't linear, like what you start off doing isn't what you end up doing, but you still have to give it 100% and just make sure if you're giving it at your all, then hopefully it works out. But at the same time, if it doesn't, then it doesn't. But you know, life still goes on. So that's kind of that's what I drive, or what I use as my driving force.
Dope.
Well, the biggest fear is you're not gonna get a contract. You know, the biggest fear is that, you know, the clients aren't going to show up. Mm. The biggest fear is that you don't got it like you thought you had it.
Right.
The biggest fear is having to go back home, you know. And I think one of the greatest lessons I learned was, you know, once you get your first one, like I remember like November last year, man, I was hopping around my house because I got a contract for $700. Mm. That is nowhere near what it would cost to pay my rent.
Right.
Right. Somebody agreed to pay me something.
Right.
Someone agreed to pay me something.
Yeah.
And I was on top of the world, man. I remember it was like 11 o'clock and I got the email and I was hopping around the house and I was so excited, man. And it's sort of like Big said, you got to make sure you keep it like it's your first one.
Yeah.
You know, now we're like, you know, we're signing five-figure deals, and so it's a little different. And now we're in the working on six-figure deals. So it's perspective, and it's a quick perspective, but man, that's scary. You know, when you don't have a job anymore, you don't have a 9-to-5, right? Nobody's job is to create revenues to support your income, and then you execute on a task to earn that income. Like that's not the transaction anymore. You know, entrepreneurship is about taking on the consequences of your truth. Mm-hmm. And anytime you have an employer, you take on the consequences and limitations of their ambitions.
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that I learned. And that was one of the reasons why I left where I was at, because I respected and I appreciated my employer. But the reality was, man, what they saw as a threat in the world, whether it was communicating about what the social realities were, what they could be, or what operational things we could engage to actually produce change in the world, or whether it was just calling out what was wrong in our city. There was a limit that I could hit as an employee before it became a conflict or a challenge. And so, but that was still my truth. My truth was still there. And people would always, like, I got offered so many jobs. I don't know what it is. It's sort of like when you're dating somebody, you know, everybody wants you. And then when you're single, they just be,
who is he?
You know? That's kind of how I felt. Because as soon as I said I was going to start this company, I started getting flooded with job offers.
Yeah.
Just unsolicited. Like, great jobs, man. Dream jobs. And I remember for a season, I was really impressed with what I realized was discipline. And being able to say no to things that I loved and I wanted to say yes to, because I had this vision. I would just tell people, like, yo, I got this thing in my chest and I got to get it out.
Yeah.
Like, I got to see if I can do this thing.
Yeah.
No matter how great the opportunity looks on the other side, or no matter how awesome, or I would love to work with those people. And the great thing is, like, I told them, hey, I would love to work with you. You can contract with my firm. Right. And for some of them, that's what we're doing now.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. So it brought them into the vision.
Yeah. So, like, to what do you attribute your success, right? Not only the courage to actually act upon this idea to make an impact, the courage to step out and be your employer. What do you attribute to that success or to that courage that you've had so far?
Man, I really think it's as soon as I realized that one of the largest impediments I had to my own success was fear. Like, really fear. Like, and you have to, like, investigate fear. And then you have to investigate its polar opposite. You have to investigate love. Right? You know, love casts out fear through courage. Not because it doesn't understand the threat. Right?
Yeah,
like, it engages and does so courageously.
Yeah.
And that, you know, nullifies the power of fear. But fear really was driving a lot of my decisions. Between, you know, everything from, you know, what I chose to live off of, to who I chose to care about, to what jobs I had, or to when I decided to launch.
Yeah.
Right? A lot of it was fear-driven and fear-motivated. And once you, like, once you let that out, you really do embrace, you dig into studying what abundance theory means. You start to understand what does faith really mean? What does spiritual truth really mean? What does being you actually mean?
Yeah.
And how powerful are you if you stand only on what you have and that's enough? If that has to be enough, then what would you do? What would you say? How would you live? And once you engage that question, those series of questions, rather, man, you take the leash off, you take the harness off. And it's an incredible feeling to wake up alive, like really alive. I tell this to a lot of folks. Like, I know I rub some white folks the wrong way when I talk about what racism is and what white supremacy is and how it pervades everything in this world.
Yeah.
But I always have to remind them that they've never been in the practice of meeting someone who's actually free. that looks like me. Mm. Right? You don't really know what free black looks like, but this is what it looks like. Now, I know you know what it feels like.
Right,
it offends you, it confuses you,
right.
It looks arrogant,
yeah,
right, it looks unapologetic, it looks all of those things, cool. Right, but all it is I'm simply saying, this is me, this is my value, now your move.
Yeah.
Right, you can do work with me, you can choose not to do work with me. I believe in myself, I believe in my community. I don't believe in a scarcity that requires me to harbor a fear that holds your fragility as more important than my power. And that, I mean, you learn a lot of that stuff with entrepreneurship. Like, you get in, you got to stand up. You got to stand up, and it teaches you.
That's what's up. That's, I think, like, oftentimes, those fears keep you from taking that step, right?
Yeah.
I know one of the things that we talked about before was not only that fear, but having someone that holds you accountable, someone who's also been through that journey that can tell you what it's like on the other side. You can see that person, right? But I think that accountability piece is really big. So, like, who have you had to kind of hold you accountable in doing, in launching and creating?
Doing what you said you were about to do.
Right.
Like, really, family.
Yeah.
Like, that's, like, the biggest thing. It's like, well, if you said you're going to do this, go ahead and do it.
Mm-hmm.
And not even outside of that, but it's, like, truly the vision. And it's, like, putting 100% of your heart into something and then having faith that this is something that is supposed to happen.
Yeah.
This is what makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, Xavier was really talking about, like, that whole fear notion. But, you know, once you kind of get over that, then you take those risks. You take those leaps. And then you just kind of get more comfortable in the decisions that you're making. But it's just, like, what are all of these constructs of, like, you need to go to school, you need to go have a job. This is just something that's man-made. Not to say that you shouldn't do that, because that's kind of what we're bound by society. But at the same time, when you look around in the workplace or you look around on the street, you just see all these people just following, like, this rigid structure. For what, though? Are they really happy? Are they really passionate? You know, everybody has his purpose. And once you realize kind of what your purpose is, then you really know that you need to go act on it. And so that was, like, something my mom has always kind of held me to, was like, there's something bigger than you out there, or you're here for a reason. So I feel that, you know, that this app or Rapunzl is kind of a gateway to get into that bigger thing. And it's like, I know I'm making an impact in other people's lives. So that really truly shows me, like, this is, I gotta go do it.
Yeah.
Even if there is the fear of, you know, failing, but I know that I've kind of built up this safety net that I'm gonna be all right. So what if somebody tells me, like, no, you need to stick with your job because it pays a good salary? And I'm like, all right, whatever. I'm gonna be all right. I'm 24 years old. Resume is decent. I can go work for somebody. But at the same time, this is, like, the only time in my life where I don't have as many responsibilities being boggled down. So I gotta go take that leap.
Yeah.
And I've always been that person. I don't know if you saw me, but I pulled up on a skateboard. I've been a risk taker. So I gotta go take the reins of my own future. I can't just be a slave to the system, so to speak.
Yeah.
Not to say there's anything wrong with that, but me knowing myself, I gotta go challenge it. Because if I don't, I'ma always have that idea or be questioning myself, what if? And that's the thing that wakes me up at night in fear. Like, I don't wanna wake up at 42 and, like, man, I had this opportunity, but I didn't go 100% with it.
Yeah.
So you just really just have to do it sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's easier said than done, but you know, like, in the inside, you kind of know.
Yeah.
And
I think this notion of, like, being passionate and having purpose in your work,
mm-hmm.
I think is kind of new. I know when I talk to, like, my mom and grandmother about, like, you know, like, I'm not connected. Granted, the type of work that I do is great, but as far as, like, the passion and the purpose that I know I have, sometimes they don't necessarily align.
Uh-huh.
And you feel that every single day that you go to work. Mm-hmm. Where, you know, an older generation would have been like, you know, like, you're not supposed to be passionate and purpose of work. You go to work.
You do it for 30 years.
You do your work, you go home. But I think that's something that a lot of, like, millennials are really pushing uh-huh. against, right? Like, no. Like,
it's also because we have different, I mean, work today is not the same as before. Now work is 24/7, man.
Right,
like,
right,
I mean, this right here. Come on, man. Like, work is not, it's, I mean, the game done changed.
Yeah, yeah.
And so if you're going to be spending not just 8 hours of your, of your actual time, but you're going to be spending, you know, 13, 14 hours of your mental work time as well, because it's still on your mind. It's still consuming your fears and all these things. Then, yo, it has changed. And you know, for the sake of not being a human, but of demanding that institutions be humane.
Yeah.
They have to understand that the extension of dignity is a human right. Like,
yeah.
And people find dignity through work that aligns with their passions in life.
Right.
The one thing I have learned with being an entrepreneur that I really have come to appreciate is the value. They need that muffler fixed. I've learned the value of people who don't want to be entrepreneurs. You know, the folks who agree to come alongside a vision. I used to be that cat when I was 23 and I got a job as the development director, the executive director, man. I love being a number two, man. I loved it. I loved it. I got to learn. I got to, you know, see him make all the mistakes and take all the L's, right?
Like, wasn't me.
you know what I mean? Like it was just the right fit for where I was at my time in my life. And quite honestly, at that time, I was afraid of taking the number one slot. And I never saw that as being for me, actually. Until I got into that mastermind and I had seven other entrepreneurs saying, you need to jump, bro, you need to jump. But it's really humbled me to understand that the evaluation of fear has to also stem from an understanding of the constraints that people have for their love for others. Mm-hmm. You know, parenting, being a caretaker to a parent, you know. Of saving, people who are saving for a thing that's coming, and so this is a means to that end. Mm-hmm. You know, all of those different manifestations of the reasons why people take up the way they do work. You know, because when you're hiring, you don't want 50 entrepreneurs on your team. Mm-hmm. Like,
right.
You don't want that, right? Yeah. You want people who, it's sort of like when you look at the HR mindset over at Apple, right? They look at the rock stars and rock stars and something else, rock, like the rocks that stay there.
Mm-hmm.
And in evaluating what type of person you're dealing with, these people that require, they have to be advanced, they have to be, you know, move right up to the next level. And there are some folks who are like, yo, I just had a kid, man, and I need about 5 years of don't touch me. Don't you just let me do my work and go home.
E30.
You know what I mean? Like, we can get this check and I'm good. I'm gonna do exactly what I'm asked to do and it's gonna be great. Like, this is the, I always say the diversity of the chaos requires the diversity of the workers.
And you see that though.
And I appreciate that about folks.
Yeah. Well, man, thank you all so much for coming out and
good to chop
chopping
it up,
with it up about what you guys are doing and hopefully inspiring other people who are interested in being an entrepreneur but have these same fears that I think everybody has when it comes to jumping out and doing your own thing. But
particularly when you're young and nobody trusts you.
That's the biggest thing.
But it's like, like you said, like, it's just that thing. It's
you
like, I know this is,
you gotta get it out.
This is what I'm supposed to be doing. But thank you all so much for sharing it with us.
Thank you.
I hope that you guys enjoyed this episode and this conversation with Miles and Xavier.
And the mosquitoes.
And the mosquitoes.
And the mosquitoes, right?
And Mothman.
And the
Mothman came through. Mothman came through. Big old Mothman.
Pulling out, you know.
If you guys want to learn more, definitely follow us on social media at Be Hopeful People. And check out our website at BeHopefulPeople.com. Thanks so much for your support. And we'll see you next time. Peace.
Hey.